Very good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for joining us at the mid-year review of the ABP News Pitch Madison Advertising Report 2020. My name is Kyati Kawa, and I'm delighted to be your host today. As you probably are aware, the Pitch Madison Advertising Report, brought out by the Exchange for Media Group and Madison Media, is the most awaited report on predictions of ad spends in the media and advertising industry. Over the years, the report has become a benchmark in the industry and is often quoted in the media, pitch presentations, company boardrooms, corporate reports, and also IPO documents filed by media companies. Now, this report tracks and analyzes how and where advertising monies are spent in the last year and also projects the future growth. It aims at understanding the challenges and opportunities that lie ahead for marketers and various media, be it print, TV, radio, out-of-home, internet, or cinema. Earlier in February this year, many of you must have joined us at the unveiling of the report, which had projected a 10.4% growth in 2020 for the ad market. Since then, the COVID setback has turned our lives and the entire businesses and industries upside down. Therefore, for the first ever time, we are unveiling a mid-year review of the report to put the COVID-19 impact into perspective and to present a forecast for H2 2020. We would like to thank our presenting partner, ABP News. Thank you for joining us in this endeavor. And also, ladies and gentlemen, I would now request all our participants, whether you are joined us on any of the social media platforms or on our very own platform, I request all of you to join us in the digital conversation using our hashtag, which is PMAR2020. So do let us know, tweet to us, use any of our platforms, and do converse with us, because this is one of a kind event that we bring to you here. And now, for the welcome address, may I invite on the screen Dr. Anurag Batra, Chairman and Editor-in-Chief, BW Business World and Exchange for Media, to say a few words, please.
Thank you, Kyati. I think Sam has and Vikram have put this together because I missed the February Pitch Madison Advertising Outlook 2020. But as you rightly said, that COVID since March has dominated headlines. It has impacted the branding, advertising, marketing domain. And luckily, the festival season is around the corner. 14 November is Diwali. We are almost 3 months away from Diwali. Today, the IPL principal sponsor was announced. Dream 11 has paid 222 crores to be the IPL 2020 principal sponsor. We at exchangeformedia.com broke that. And subsequently, everyone has picked that. So really, we are talking at a time where the advertising and marketing activity has started to pick up. The billion or the trillion dollar question is, how much advertising will come back? Will we make up for the loss of advertising in March, April, May, June, July? So how much advertising should we expect in September, October, November, December? So that's the question on everybody's mind in the advertising, marketing, media domain. So Sam and his team, Vikram, everyone at Madison has put together this mid-year review, which everyone in the media, marketing, advertising industry is looking forward to. I don't want to steal the thunder from Sam's presentation, but I can only say that looking at the report, it confirms that whenever there is rain, look for rainbows. Whenever there is darkness, look for stars. So there are lots of rainbows and lots of stars in the Pitch Madison Advertising Report 2020, the mid-year version. So I look forward to both as Exchange for Media and as a media owner in business world, I look forward to looking at the numbers. I think the only hint I would say, the environment is improving for a lot of sectors, and you'll see the granularity in the report. So all the best for the festive season. It will be better than what it is now. That's a given. How much better? You'll know soon. What will be better? You'll know soon. So back to you, Kathy, for getting Sam and the Madison team in.
Thank you so much, Dr. Batra. I know there are so many questions. What is it going to be? Were the predictions that were told or in fact mentioned in the February edition of the report, would they be true? How different they are? There are so many questions like Dr. Batra mentioned, and all of them will be answered by someone who I'm going to invite next on the screen. It is now time, ladies and gentlemen, to listen in to a man who honestly needs no introduction, but let me just try to say a few words about him. He is recognized as one of the most influential persons in the media and entertainment industry and continues to lead Madison as the largest independent media and advertising agency in the country. With more than 30 years at the forefront of the media and advertising industry, Mr. Sam Balsara, chairman of Madison World, has an ocean of knowledge and insights that very few in the industry have. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I hope all of you are ready to listen in to Mr. Sam Balsara, who will share with us the key highlights from the mid-year review of the Pitch Madison Advertising Report 2020. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Kathy. And good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This time I come before you under unique circumstances that I have not witnessed in my 48 years of working life, and I'm sure nor have you. The transient nature of everything around us has once again been reinforced by the pandemic. In the past 5 months, the way we live, the way we spend our money, the way we work has all changed. And this has had a catastrophic effect on the business world and, of course, our advertising and media world was no exception. Since so much change has taken place in the last few months, we thought you would welcome an opportunity to hear our views on what happened in quarter one and quarter two, especially quarter two, and what one can expect in the second half. Now, it's generally known that in quarter two, ADX has collapsed. But let us see to what extent. It's also not so widely known that ADX in fact contracted in quarter 1-2, that is Jan, Feb, March. Perhaps for the first time in many decades, we estimate a drop in H1 20 of as high as 39%, and this is made up of a drop as high as 65% in quarter two and a drop of 8% in quarter one versus corresponding period last year. Even the poster boy of ADX Digital, which has been driving growth of ADX in the last few years, could not withstand the impact of COVID-19 and contracted by 7%. Of course, this figure is insignificant in comparison to the 47% drop that traditional media witnessed. Looking at it quarter-wise, in quarter two, traditional media suffered a drop of 71%, whereas digital got by with a drop that was half of traditional media at 35%. Television and digital seem to be bouncing back from June, but other mediums like print, cinema, and outdoor have not been so fortunate. Print is showing some signs of revival from July. It is significant to note that ADX has shown a negative growth in H1, even if for comparison purposes, you exclude events such as IPL, ICC World Cup and general elections from H1 19. The only growth we saw in 2020 came in digital adex in Q1 20. In absolute terms, adex has degrown from 35,110 crores in H1 to 21,298 crores in H1 2020, a drop of almost 14,000 crores. We believe adex has not seen a drop as dramatic as this in anyone's living memory. The performance of PV adex in H1 has reinforced our view that TV continues to be the staple diet for most regular advertisers, and it continues to be the largest contributor to adex with a 38% share in H1. Digital has displaced print, having grown in share from 20% in H1 19 to 30% in H1 20, whereas print has lost share by 5 percentage points, dropping from 30 in H1 19 to 25 in H1 20. We see a wide variation of growth rates amongst different mediums in H1. All traditional mediums degrew by more than 50% in H1, except TV, which degrew a little less by 43%. The least drop was experienced by digital, as I said earlier, at 7%. In terms of category growth, whilst every category shows a drop, telecom, travel, clothing, fashion, and durables were the worst hit. FMCG predictably showed up to be the most resilient, and its share moved up to 38% compared to 33% it had in full year 2019. Despite so much talk about auto industry facing a demand slump, auto still comes in as the second largest sector with an 8% contribution. Let's see how top advertisers behaved in H1. Predictably, the top 50 list has as many as 20 FMCG advertisers, and the top 10 list has as many as 8 FMCG advertisers. Hindustan Unilever continues to top the elite list by a wide margin. Amazon has dropped in rank from number 2 to number 4, as we believe e-commerce adoption galloped, indicating that they did not need to do so much advertising to maintain and grow their sales. The top 50 advertisers together now spend 83%, last year it was 78% of their budgets, on a combination of television and digital, which seem to have become the top advertisers' favorite mediums. This also indicates that large advertisers are over-indexed on their spends in TV and digital. HUL, in our estimate, spent about 1,300 to 1,500 crores, followed by P&G, Reckitt, Amazon, and Maruti. Cadbury, GlaxoSmithKline, ITC, Colgate, and Godrej Consumer makes it to the top 10 list and grew substantially up in rank. In our list, we have 13 new players when compared with 2019, all featuring in the second half from rank 26 to 50. Some among them are Pepsi, Rohit Surfactants, Shaadi.com, SBI, Abbott Healthcare, and Ultratech Cement. Among the top 50 players, there's a lot of change in ranks. Only 3 players maintained rank, 24 gained in rank, and 10 dropped in rank. Prominent amongst those who lost rank are Vini, Reliance, Mahindra, and Vivo Mobile. Surprisingly, Dream 11, which was part of the top 5 advertisers in our list of 2019, for the first time, now doesn't feature in our top 50 in H1, perhaps due to absence of live sporting events. But as we heard today, they're coming back with a bang, having won the IPL naming sponsorship bid. Let's come specifically now to quarter two and see what has been the impact of COVID on Indian ADEX in this quarter. For the first time since digital registered its presence in ADEX, in our estimate, digital medium has degrown in quarter two and degrown by as much as 35%. Of course, traditional medium dropped at double the rate at 71%, resulting in an overall degrowth in quarter two of 65%. Coming to individual mediums in quarter two, more than 80% of ADEX contribution is by TV and digital together, highest till date. Print contributes to a marginal 18%, while radio, OH, and cinema were all insignificant. Print contribution has come down to 18%. OH and cinema drew an almost blackout. Radio registered a billing in our estimate of just 71 crores and ended with a share of just 1%. Predictably, the months of April and May, the first two full months of lockdown, were the worst ever for ADEX, despite the huge fillip in viewership and higher time spent by audiences. TV dropped dramatically in ADEX terms by 61%, and even good discounts offered by many media, except news channels, could not bring most advertisers to ADEX. A large number of advertisers disappeared in quarter two from ADEX. We see that almost more than half the advertisers disappeared from print and radio, and a quarter from TV. After two disastrous months of April and May, as Unlock 1.0 unfolded, ad inventory on TV and digital started to come back in June 20, but perhaps at a slightly lower price point. Full recovery will take time and depend on when the lockdown ends. Let's now take a closer look at individual mediums. First, we'll start with television. TV ADEX dropped by more than 40%, 43 to be precise, in H1, and registered a market share of 38%, down from 40% in H1 19. Now, as I said earlier, if you think this degrowth is because of the absence of Lok Sabha elections, which took place in H1, or the absence of IPL and World Cup, I have to tell you that even if you ignore these three mega events, the drop in H1 is still a whopping 28%, and the drop is 42% if we consider only quarter two. It is also significant that, like most of the other mediums, traditional mediums, in quarter one, that is Jan, Feb, March, when COVID had not raised its ugly head in India, TV AdX dropped by 13%, which is a poor reflection on our state of the economy. FMCG increased its dominance in TV AdX with a share of 56%, higher than the 2019 figure of 49%. This is primarily due to increase in advertising by newer, what we call COVID categories in personal hygiene, like sanitizer, hand wash liquids, disinfectant sprays, and multiple products related to immunity building, and of course, lower spends by other categories. E-commerce, including OTT and other social media platforms, also contribute to 8% of the overall TV pie. All other categories showed a degrowth in H1 20, with highest drop being witnessed predictably in travel, tourism, telecom, beverages, auto, and durables. An analysis of FCT beamed by various genres shows that all genres have degrown by at least 10 to 20% in H1, and some like music degrew by 44% and English movies by 41%. This drop is much higher in quarter 2020. Despite there not being any live sporting events in quarter two, the drop in sports is much lower at 15%. TV FCT volume also dropped by 13% in H1 and by 21% in quarter two. The COVID-19 period has seen a spike in media consumption and total viewership on TV, despite there being no original content, all attributed to the stay-at-home and work-from-home norms. However, unfortunately, this rise in viewership has not translated into TV AdX because of lack of money, advertising money, in the market. Sharp drop in AdX is on account of the fact that many advertisers, 1171 to be precise, skipped advertising altogether on television, and many large advertisers who continued to advertise brought down their advertising budgets. TV has been the first to get off the block, and June has brought in cheer for TV AdX, signifying that some categories cannot afford to stay away from TV advertising for too long to sustain their market shares and for fear of losing share to competition. This to us is also an indication that advertisers have confidence that demand will revive and advertising can play a big role in fueling it. This revival has sustained in July, and indications are that it will do so also in August. Let's now take some time to review digital. As I said earlier, digital too suffered a minor degrowth of just 7% compared to other media that suffered a contraction of 40 to 55%. In absolute terms, digital adex in H1, in our estimate, stood at about 6,500 crores. Looking at digital adex in H1 by its various verticals, in our estimate, search, social, video, and display each contribute between 20 and 30% to the total pie. Video maintains its share of 30%, continuing to be the largest contributor. Social media with a spike in spends came in next with a share of 26%. E-commerce advertising platforms have made their presence felt with a 10% share. Digital now contributes to 30% in H1. It was only 18% just 2 years back, and has firmly displaced print, which declined in share from 30 to 25 in H1. Imagine share gain from 18 to 30 in 2 years. During quarter two, digital media unfortunately also suffered the COVID effect and dropped by a substantial 35%. Of course, this drop must be seen in comparison to the drop of 79% in print and 61% in TV. Categories that have outperformed through COVID-19 period are what we call EFGH, E for e-commerce, entertainment, and edutech, F for food tech, fintech, and FMCG, G for gaming, groceries, and government, and H for health tech and healthcare. Let's take a look at our old favorite, print. The second largest medium in adex, print, of course, suffered a major setback in H120. Not only did quarter two see a drop because of lockdown when newspaper distribution stopped in many parts of the country, but quarter one also saw a drop of 17% because of a slowing economy. The full H120 in our estimate has degrown by 51%. In absolute terms, H120 print adex is estimated at 5,237 crores, of which as much as 4,020 crores came in quarter one itself. Categories like FMCG, auto, and education continue to be the main contributors and contributed almost 40% share to print adex. It was 38% in 2019. Education, with a 16% contribution, has overtaken FMCG as the largest contributor to print adex, dethroning FMCG, which came second at 15%. Despite the setback faced by the auto industry in the market, it ranks third in contribution to print adex at 14%. 16, 13, 14. Publications across languages show a drop in space consumed of more than 50%. English and Hindi publications continue to dominate and contribute close to 60% of total volume, similar to what it has achieved in recent years. The only positive sign that print publications can draw from this lockdown is the increase in adoption of their e-paper versions, and sooner or later, most publications can be expected to monetize this trend. In terms of volume or space consumed, there is a 53% decline in H1 and, not so surprisingly, a 77% decline in volume in quarter two. Print suffered a major decline during April, May, June COVID-19 quarter, and in our estimate dropped by almost 80% and registered a value of just 1200 crores approximately. All publications took a big hit during the lockdown. As a result, the print medium, which has in the last few years contributed at least 30% to total ADEX, has dropped in share to 18%. However, some green shoots have begun to appear from late June. Over 40,000 advertisers, or more than half the usual number, disappeared from print ADEX during April, May, June quarter, having reduced in numbers from as many as 70,801 in quarter 2 19 to 28,608 in quarter 2 20. Now let's see what happened in outdoor. Overall, outdoor ADEX declined by 55% in first half of the year and closed at 760 crore. On account of this, OH share of total ADEX, which has always been above 5%, has come down to 4% in H1. Outdoor advertisers were quick to realize that because of empty roads, the effectiveness of outdoor would dramatically decline, and therefore the OH industry recorded almost nil billings in quarter two, with some campaigns trickling in towards second half of June 20. Even quarter one was a bit lackluster, with ADEX having degrown by 13% in Jan-Feb-March over the same quarter last year. While lockdown across cities and towns led to no specific spending in outdoor, many municipalities mandated outdoor owners to display corona messages free of cost, adding to their woes. The lockdown has significantly changed user mobility pattern, and current traffic movements are very different compared to pre-COVID traffic movements. Realizing this, we at Madison launched an extension to our site evaluation tool to measure traffic count, which showed that traffic is back to around 50 to 60% on major arterial roads and circles in metro cities, but revival in outdoor ADEX is yet to take place in any noticeable way. Let's now take a look at radio. Like print, radio has also been severely hit by the slowing of economy in quarter one and the lockdown in quarter two. The cumulative impact of drop in both these quarters is that Radio ADX has dropped to half its size, dropped by 52%. In absolute terms, Radio ADX stood at just 569 crores for H1 20. In H1 20, Radio held on to its market share of 3%, same as H1 19, because other media also dropped in size. Almost every category on radio seems to have got affected by the lockdown. BFSI, auto, e-commerce, FMCG, and real estate, though, are the categories that stand out. In terms of category contribution, BFSI leads the pack, contributing to 13%, followed by FMCG at 10%. The ad inventory of most radio stations dropped by more than 70% in quarter two and dropped by more than 40% in first half. Even good discounts offered by many broadcasters failed to bring advertisers back into the radio market, and we saw 50% of advertisers drop out compared to normal times in these 3 months. Like in print, almost half the advertisers, as many as 2,000, disappeared from radio in April, May, June. Like for TV, radio listenership too has increased in the last few months, but radio could not monetize this increase, mainly because of lack of money in the advertising market. In absolute terms, Radio ADX in quarter two did a billing of just 71 crores in our estimate, registering an 87% drop. With this drop, radio's market share in ADX dropped to just 1% in AMJ quarter. Lastly, let's take a look at cinema. The nationwide lockdown due to COVID pandemic has knocked out cinema as a medium, with all cinemas ordered shut in quarter two. Quarter one registered also a lackluster performance, with cinema ADX in our estimate dropping by 16% and doing a billing of just 176 crores. With quarter two being nil, H1 dropped by 52% as compared with H1 19. Even as cinemas remain closed till date, indications are that when they open, will be allowed to operate at only 25% capacity for a few months, which will no doubt add to the miseries of cinema owners. So let us now come to the all-important forecast, which in the current fluid circumstances, you will agree is a bit of a challenge to make, but nevertheless, we have ventured to predict a range in which we see ADX settling in H2. We expect ADX to recover in H2 and grow at a dramatic rate that will range from 60 to 72% over the subdued first half of this year, or grow 6 to 13% over the second half of 2019. this will lead to a full year ADEX contracting by 14%-18% and ADEX value to reach pessimistically to settle a little over 2017 level or optimistically a little below 2018 ADEX level. H2 ADEX will, of course, primarily depend on demand coming back in markets, which will depend on sentiment and consumers' outlook of the immediate future, which in our view will also depend on when government and private offices are allowed to open and work on a regular basis. Nevertheless, we are optimistic because we believe that enlightened advertisers will do their best to stimulate demand and will need to advertise to protect their share. They cannot continue with a wait and watch approach for more than 6 months. Moreover, the two largest mediums, television and digital, have already started showing signs of robust revival in June and July. Digital, the fastest growing medium, we believe, has almost recorded a V-shaped recovery. We expect digital to continue its growth path unabated and forecast a growth of as much as 28%-38% over H2 19. TV, we believe, will also get back in full form. TV has shown early signs of getting back to normalcy and should get back in form by September or October latest, aided by the launch of IPL, impact shows like KBC, Big Boss, and many more. Whilst radio, outdoor, and cinema have not yet shown signs of revival, we believe the festive season should see traction for these mediums. Cinema ADEX will, of course, depend on when government will allow them to open and when audiences will start visiting them. Looking at full year 2020 and comparing it to 2019, we expect digital, the poster boy, which has registered unprecedented growth in the last 5 years, to be the only medium to grow on a full year basis. All other mediums, unfortunately, will decline in our estimate. TV should see the lowest decline of 12%-17% and cinema the highest of 40%-60%. Our full report will give you details of each individual medium and the figures we expect them to reach. Finally, we would like to end as usual with some advice for all my advertiser friends. Our first advice, and actually our belief, is that advertisers should not and will not sacrifice brand building efforts to protect their profits in H2 20. They know that advertising is the cheapest known stimulus to stimulate demand and retain and build share. Enlightened advertisers know that share, once lost, is extremely difficult and extremely expensive to regain. Our second piece of advice is that advertisers should focus on supply chain management and make it robust, and also focus on advertising inputs in select high potential districts of semi-urban and rural India. Madison's Town and Country software tool can help advertisers to identify these high potential districts in semi-urban and rural areas, and these districts are likely to yield higher returns to advertising investments. A third piece of advice is predictably for advertisers to focus on e-commerce and set high targets as percent contribution to sales from e-commerce. Adoption of e-commerce during April, May, June period has been very good and high, and key advertisers are reporting substantial growth in e-commerce contribution to sales. Digital adoption during the lockdown period is likely to continue beyond the lockdown, and advertisers should hone in their capabilities and expertise in these channels. Finally, we would like to end with some unsolicited advice for all my media friends. I don't know if it will be welcome, but here it is. In our view, media should be as flexible as possible and try to attract as much advertising as possible and help advertisers maximize their return on advertising investments at a time like this. It is in media's interest to attract as much advertising as possible in volume terms and not in terms of cost per unit in H220 especially. This will help bring demand back into the economy and push the economy into an upward spiral, which in turn can only benefit media. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for listening to me. The report will be available soon, later in the evening, and we'll probably mail many of you a copy, and hopefully you will be able to lay your hands on it quite easily.
Thank you so much, Sam, for that detailed review on the report. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is time to unveil the much anticipated mid-year review of the ABP News Presents Pitch Madison Advertising Outlook H1 2020. Here we go, everyone. I hope all of you are ready. Without further ado, we present to you the Pitch Madison Advertising Outlook H1 2020. Let's take a look. Well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen, the mid-year review of the Pitch Madison report. Don't forget to keep your conversations going with us on Twitter or any other social media platforms using our hashtag PMAR2020. And now, may I please call upon Mr. Naval Ahuja, co-founder Exchange for Media, to share with us his thoughts on the report. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Kyati, and thank you, Sam, for enlightening all of us. And if I remember correctly, I think this is the third time we've done a mid-year review. So, and this year happens to be the most unprecedented of all. The first mid-year review we had done during the last global economic crisis, which was in 2008. Then we did another one 2-3 years back, and now a third one. And as expected, this is amongst the most gloomiest ones. And one of the, I think, very critical points you mentioned towards the end, which is advice for advertisers. I think it is a very important role for all of us in the advertising and the media business to ensure that a lot of advertisers who've been focusing more on performance-driven and lead-driven marketing over the last few months naturally are moved towards desire-driven advertising, and media rates obviously play a very, very important part there, flexibility from media side. And I was talking to a couple of friends in the morning, and a lot of them, especially from television, told me that September looks like a month when they'll be back to an index of 100. So that, I would imagine, is very good news. But I think one of the other important aspects that, you know, which your report highlights is the fact that it is not just COVID that has led to degrowth. We were already degrowing in Q1. And as many of you must have experienced, January was a growth month, and then February, March onwards, things started going down. There's an important lesson for us, all of us there, which is that all the, you know, what we call convergence of TMT in our business, which is technology, media, and telecom, is shaking up our business models. It is disrupting business models, and perhaps media owners especially, and to some extent, advertising agencies also need to be very aware of that larger trend. And COVID kind of accelerates that trend. We might get back to an index of 100 in September and the months thereafter, but the fact that the larger disruption that is happening in the media space because of technology, because of access to telecom, is here to stay, and that will accelerate that as we go along. I was over the weekend reading a very interesting book, which I would recommend to all of you. That's the autobiography of Bob Iger, the CEO of Disney. And he's been in that position for 15 odd years. And he explains how in 2005, when he took over the position of the CEO, he consciously presented to the board that because of the forces of technology, they need to reinvent their own business. And to reinvent first, they have to disrupt their own business. And I think that's a need a lot of us media owners in India are already seeing. And perhaps it is also time to look at consumers to pay more, you know, because media is clearly in India under-indexed when it comes to getting money from consumers. A lot of attempt has been made. Entertainment television has become better when it has come to get consumers to paying. Perhaps news media and print also needs to monetize the consumer end more. Before I go, as Sam started his presentation by saying, this festive season is a critical one. Somebody said this is the fifth quarter of the year. Hopefully things will improve, but we all need to look at how, you know, we fight the forces of disruption, and post-COVID we come out stronger, especially with the learnings that this has given us. So thank you for all of you for joining us. We look forward to the panel now being moderated by Vikram. So back to you, Khyati, and look forward to the panel, Vikram.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ahuja. And definitely, it is this very interesting panel that we all are looking forward to. But before that, I'd definitely like to take this opportunity and thank our tech partner, ladies and gentlemen, Uplife from Madison Turnt. And here is a glimpse of what this platform holds. Let's take a look.
Oh,
Yes, so once again, thank you to our tech partner, UpLive by Madison Turnt. Ladies and gentlemen, we are now moving on to a very interesting segment, one that many of you are awaiting eagerly. I'm sure of that. While it has been a really challenging 2020, so far the festive season is also just around the corner, and it's something that the entire marketing ecosystem is gearing up for. Now, to discuss the upcoming festive season and how it can be leveraged for maximum impact, and it is my pleasure now to introduce our esteemed panelists and the industry leaders onto the screen. First up, ladies and gentlemen, we have with us Amit Singhal, Managing Director and CEO of Asian Paints. Thank you for joining us today, Amit. Next, may I invite Kunal Bell, Co-Founder and CEO of Snapdeal. Glad to have you join us, ladies and gentlemen. Kunal Bell from Snapdeal. We also have with us Rohit Gupta, President, Sony Pictures Network. Of course, we are delighted to have you, Rohit. And ladies and gentlemen, we also have with us Mr. Avinash Pandey, CEO, ABP Network. A very warm welcome to you too. And also a very warm welcome to Shailesh Gupta, Director, Jagran Prakashan Limited. Thank you so much for joining all of you here with us today. I'd now like to introduce you to our moderator for this very promising panel discussion. I now invite Vikram Sakhuja, Group CEO, Media and Out of Home Madison, to kindly take over. Also, before...
Thank you, Kirpi. And a very warm welcome to all of you who have tuned in. And a very warm welcome to the fantastic panelists that we have here. Hi, Amit, Kunal, Shailesh, Avinash, and Rohit. You know, a lot of what said, whether it's going to be 6 to 13% growth versus year ago, a lot of it is really going to be dependent on how the entire festive months plan out. Typically, the 10 weeks preceding Diwali accounts for, which is 20% of the year, accounts for something like 30 to 35% of the ADEX in these 10 weeks. With IPL there this time, it could go upwards of 40, 45%. Now, a lot of advertisers and marketers are really hoping that the famed or the expected V-shaped recovery is really going to happen on the back of the festival. So who better to weigh in on this very, very important topic than a person who has a visibility to the entire marketplace, a person who is probably running one of the, I mean, it's a company whose value has increased tenfold over the years, probably is one of the ones which has the entire supply line system completely down to a T, and is one of the most aggressive growing kind of companies for him to weigh in. And of course, we've got our friends from TV and print who are actually going to be telling us just how each of the mediums is going to stack up. So, you know, the way I'm going to quickly go about this is I want to first cover a few aspects. I want to cover the supply chain. I want to cover the entire part about sentiment. Then I want to see how people are going to be spending this money. And of course, I'd like to have some nice closing thoughts from all of you. So, you know, let's start with the entire supply chain piece. And I know that when this entire disaster hit us in end of March, beginning April, even those categories where like FMCGs and all, where the demand was all there, even they shut down because very simply there was no supply. There was a lockdown, so factories were shut, stores were shut, the migrants had gone home, and a whole lot of supply had broken down. So let's start the discussion with a reality check. We know that advertising doesn't start until supply is completely or at least moderately in shape. So let's, Kunal, let's start with you. You have an overview of the full marketplace in terms of supply chain working. Do you think things are back to near normal now?
Thanks, Vikram, for having me, and pleasure being here, and great to be with all the esteemed panelists. You know, actually, I do feel at the outset this will continue to be a volatile year where we'll have moments of euphoria and moments of pain, followed by more moments of euphoria and pain. And it'll take some time before all of this probably stabilizes nicely. So at least from retail e-commerce and at least online retail e-commerce standpoint, we were down to zero for a couple of months, probably starting end March, going until mid-May. And thereafter, we saw a fairly sharp recovery where, e-commerce companies were reporting anywhere from 100 to 130, 140% of pre-lockdown volumes by July, which is sort of consistent with our experience as well. That said, I think we all started celebrating a bit too soon. And come August, with a lot of the, our country has floods in many states right now. There are these intermittent lockdowns that are happening, sometimes on the weekend, sometimes on just irregular days of the month. And all of those are wreaking very, very significant havoc on the supply chain as we speak right now. But hopefully this is temporary and rains will subside in a month's time. And by the time the festive season is upon us in a month and a half or two, things should improve considerably. At least we are all banking on that as well. Because at least from the e-commerce landscape, we've seen that a lot of the sellers and the brands on marketplaces, they are depending very, very significantly this year on e-commerce to drive their sales. And as I was hearing Sam earlier, to make up for lost time during the festive season this year. So I would say my current view is cautiously optimistic. I won't call it undeniably optimistic, and I won't call it pessimistic for sure. I think I'm somewhere in the middle, and I would say most people would likely be most people who have a digital bent in their business would likely be feeling the same way.
Great. Well, thanks. Amit, Asian Paints has arguably got the strongest supply chain in the entire country. Is there any advice that you can give companies struggling on this score?
Okay, great. Thanks, Vikram, for inviting me. And I think good to see, great panel here to that extent. See, when we look at our category is something which is close to a discretionary category. So, it's not something like a food or a digital consumption, which kind of really goes on. It's something which is really discretionary because you can always put off painting and you can really kind of look at deferring that to some other date. So from our point of view, for us as well, as Kunal said that, most of the April was a washout, and it was only till about the first week of May that we really started kind of really getting back into shape in terms of what is there. And given the fact that we have huge plants across the country, one to stop and start a plant is not something which is very easy, okay? And when you stop a large chemical plant, there are processes and things which kind of go into it, which is not really easy to restart in a jiffy to that extent. And therefore, I think it came with its own kind of problems in terms of what is it. But I think given the, the way we dealt with it, the good part was that we were anyway staring on a large inventory which we had because we closed a little bit abruptly in March, given the lockdown, the way it was announced. And we had good material with us in terms of looking at really fulfilling the pent up kind of demand which was there in the market to that extent, and that kind of really helped us. And the real focus which we really maintained was looking at the entire tier 3, tier 4 in May and June, because that's something which these cities were largely not really kind of plagued with COVID, so to say, and they were literally kind of a little bit normal in terms of their disposition, in terms of how it looked. And therefore, I think May we did quite well with almost 80% of our base in terms of the volumes we could do. And I think June was spectacular. We did a double digit volume growth, which was there. But a lot of that stuff was also stimulated in the market by us by doing a lot of work around really getting the paranoia off the customer's mind in terms of looking at how safe painting can be and how they can get people into their houses to kind of paint. So overall, I think the supply chain kind of shot back very strongly. And given the fact that our supply chain is very technologically controlled, I think we kind of got our forecasting models very strongly aligned in terms of looking at saying that by not expending so much of working capital, you were still able to kind of control your inventories at the same time, looked at catering to the demand which was coming, which was patchy across the country. We didn't know that there was a clear pattern which was coming out of it, but I think we sailed through it well. And as I kind of look at it, I think quarter one, overall, when we look at it, you know, we were down almost by about 40% on top line, okay, which was not bad given the category in terms of what we are. And since then, we are seeing an upward surge, whether it is July, in terms of seeing in terms of the type of things which are happening to that extent. And while, yes, what Kunal said, there is this whole paradigm change of sporadic lockdowns, which kind of keep on coming in all shapes and sizes on all days, kind of a zone. You know, you still seem to be sailing off still better in terms of looking at what you can do in terms of stimulating demand to that extent. So therefore, I think the supply chain has reacted extremely well in terms of adapting to the new norm in that way. And as we see it today, I think things are not going to change so fast. Okay. And I am not giving it till March that things are going to change. But I think as marketers and as corporates, we need to kind of see in terms of how do we adjust to this new norm. And within this new norm, we start keep on looking at in terms of stimulating demand, looking at new ways, looking at innovation, looking at new marketing norms in terms of what we need to do, new media strategies in terms of what we need to do. And therefore, I think while there are monsoons, we are seeing monsoons slightly more positively, because I think given the larger agrarian economy we are, I think we see that definitely this will have a good effect with respect to some of the rural incomes which are going to come about as we look at future. And therefore, I think we are definitely seeing that there might not be an upsurge in terms of what looks like a big festival season. But I don't see that it would be something which would be an absolutely blank kind of a state in terms of coming in. So there is some level of optimism there in terms of how things kind of look at. And I think supply chains are really gearing to kind of cater to it.
Great. So we've got some great learnings to start the state of the bats. It is going to be a volatile year. There is a need for better forecasting, having good amount of technology to actually fuel your entire supply chain. And of course, being close to your markets to see which ones are working and then to allay the concerns of your customers. So while this is from the marketer standpoint, even from the media supply chain, Shailesh, one of the issues that advertisers keep on asking right now is, as far as print is concerned, there is a real concern that has print really come back and is circulation back to what it was earlier? And given that we don't have too much data through ABC or whatever, even IRS won't be coming for a while, how would you like to allay the concerns of people about print supply chain being back in scale?
Thank you, Vikram, for making me a part of this panel, and thank you everybody for making me be here. As far as supply, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. As far as supply chain, or for us, the circulation is concerned, I think in our area of operation, which is basically north, UP, Bihar, Uttarakhand, Jharkhand, our circulation was affected in the month of May and June, but from July onward, and our effective the amount which was affected was not more than 60%, 40%. So we were still doing a circulation of about 60-65%, but slowly and surely our circulation now has come back to about 80-85%. Why I say that? Because 15 or 20% which we are still affected is because of our NCR market, Gurgaon and Delhi. The effect of the newspaper circulation mainly happened in the metros where there was community living or where there were tall buildings. Here in our area of operation, we do not have too many multi-stories like Mumbai or Delhi or Gurgaon. So our effectiveness of the newspaper, in fact, in the entire COVID time, newspaper really played a very, very big role for the local citizens, because they were actually getting the information which they wanted, which was in and around where they live. And the newspaper really played a very, very vital role. So I do not know where this perception of thing came that the circulations have been affected. Of course, most of our clients and agencies are based out of metros, and metros were one of the main reasons why this whole thing followed. But as far as our area of operation is concerned, still as we talk, we are sitting up in around 80-85% of circulation. And our supply chain, which is hawkers and to the last mile, has never been affected.
Let's hope your voice reaches the people sitting living in the high rises and the metros are also the advertisers. Rohit, general entertainment is another one which has got affected by COVID, because that's the time when GEC has always been the place which has got the lion's share of the ad spends. And then, of course, the entire program, fresh programming, shut down for 2-3 months. Share of general entertainment went down. I know Sony did reasonably well, in fact, very well in that period, because you were still able to hold on to audiences. But in general, GEC had some kind of setback. Now, as you move with fresh programming, hopefully coming back in, you're going to face the second double, the double whammy of IPL, which typically erodes another 10-15% of GEC. What is the kind of, from a general entertainment standpoint, what is the message you'd like to give out that all is well as far as eyeballs and that supply chain is concerned?
Yeah. So thank you for having me on this panel. Yeah, it's great to be amongst everybody here. So quick one, you know, just to recap how the TV business has progressed. You know, April really hit us bad. We were down to 20% in terms of value. And since then, it's been going month on month. And, you know, we've done enough forecasting to a multinational company headquartered out of LA. Most of our time went in for the biggest forecast that we've done. And happy to say that, you know, we see better on each of our forecasts. So, you know, April was better than what we predicted. Better, and July was really the surprise. And August looks extremely good. We assume at least 80-85% pre-COVID levels for the business. That beat any one of our expectations at the time we forecasted early in May, June. So volumes are back. Discounting, which was a big role in the first quarter to get volumes in there, that's kind of slowly going in, the fresh programming coming in. We are now, all the mainline broadcasters are fully now ready with the fresh programming. Nobody is holding back. So whether it is our KPC, Kapil, the dance, you know, everybody, whether it's Big Boss or any other format, nobody's holding back during the festive. So everybody's coming out with their full pitch out into the market. Because the TV consumption has gone up substantially, we couldn't monetize it earlier. Now it's time to monetize it. And I think while IPL is there, yes, there will be advertisers from there over there. But it's not going to be easy, because today you need to understand that when IPL happens in the first quarter, there are no options for advertisers except IPL. So there's nothing against it. Now every broadcaster has you know, a couple of properties to pitch against, and these are properties which are always great. So I think advertisers have options, but yes, you know, there is room for everybody. And like I said, in August, July, August especially were brilliant. And I see if the, you know, as Sam also mentioned in his report, that TV is very strong and going to come back. Well, yes, you know, I think the comeback will be faster than we expected, at least on TV, because the kind of reach which TV delivers, there is no other medium. And the accountability which TV delivers, there's also no other medium. And digital is growing. Today, you know, a lot of brands are moving away from digital because there is no accountability on digital. So I think when the money is tough, people need the best ROIs, and today TV gives you the best ROI. So I think, you know, in tough times, we've also seen in 2008, TV was a medium that did relatively well because of the accountability. And I think that will play a key role for large advertisers to look at. Because every dollar they spend, every rupee they spend, they want to see what returns they want.
Okay, so from the advertisers, the marketers, saying going for cautious optimism. So far, both print and TV have gone for total all-out optimism. for the second half. That's great.
No, no, so, Avinash, all right. I'm not saying all out, but I'm saying to what the situation presented us in the first quarter, we said is going to be doomed. That's not going to be the case.
Yeah, I would completely agree with you, and I hope it stays that way. Avinash, I'm going to ask you a slightly tough question, and that look, what we saw an unprecedented increase in share of news channels that went from 7% to 21% with COVID. That was a brilliant opportunity for news to reinvent itself and sort of hold on to that great share growth that it got. But unfortunately, they just did more of the same. And now, 3 months, 4 months later, the share is back to 8-9%. Isn't that a hugely missed opportunity?
Well, that's the different way of thinking from an agency person to a person who is responsible to disseminate news and information in these critical times. As my colleague Salesh said, that you know, the people in Bihar and UP are consuming and seeing things very differently than what people in Delhi and Bombay Metro saw. And so at that point of time, yes, the way the news is always, I'm sorry, it's a public platform, I can't use that word, but the pecking order, the way the media planners and buyers have put the news, GC, sports, XY, and then followed by news, was all upstaged. Everybody wanted to be on the news. The problem with the news broadcasters are twofold, one on the supply side and one on the demand side. A, we were too many. B, most of us were chasing the same goose, which is how many COVID cases happening and what preventive measures you can do. So there was not so much differentiated content available everywhere else, though people wanted to know more and more about it. And third one, there was not so much of demand if you look at in the end of March, April, and most part of the May. And because of that, the FMCG's companies were the only one who were chasing the advertising inventory, and thus it created pressure on the advertising sales side to sell. But we had, on the other hand, Vikram and Sam sitting negotiating the determining what price these guys would be able to sell at, and that actually ended up giving all these broadcasters a lot of discounts. More importantly, what I would like to say, what Amit said, you know, is that when we talked about V-shape and U-shape recovery, you know, in India, Indian economy, I always tell my people, is driven by two factors: marriages and festivals. June was a season of marriage in India. So even if you look at the threshold, and if you remember the news that came at that point of time, that one IT grad was getting married in Bihar and they forced him to come despite having a COVID and some 100 people got infected. Your scale went down, but still the marriages were happening, and certain amount of purchase which goes with it, like you buy a house, you buy what is inside the house, you travel, whatever mode that it is available, you buy clothes, and you consume a lot of products. And that's what actually, June inventory, you can see on different TV channels, was of a very high level. Festivals are muted, but still the expenditure will happen. And hence, I'm quite hopeful that what a famous Harvard economist, Richard Witter, said in month of May, that India is the only country which will have a faster U-shaped recovery. Nobody is going to have. If you look at a shorter term, it's U-shaped recovery. But if you look at a long term period, it is a V-shaped recovery. But India has a faster recovery because our economy is not dependent so much on import and exports. And we are a largely consumption-based economy. We all consume what we produce internally. And hence, I see for TV channels, media salespeople who are watching right now, as a huge opportunity still to leverage, because the audience curiosity about news is still that high.
Okay. I hope I answered your question. No, you didn't actually answer my question as to how they didn't grab the idea to sort of retain some share growth. But I think you still talked about the importance of news, and that remains, of course.
I spoke about the importance of being Vikram Sakhuja. So,
no, but I think it's a great segue into the heart of what we want to talk about today, which is, what does it take to stimulate consumer spending? Amit, you know, there are some advertisers who believe that it's their job to stimulate demand, and marketing and investment actually leads demand. There are others who we are finding who are waiting for some kind of top line recovery before spending, because they just feel that P&L management is very important. I would like your thoughts on the psychology of advertisers and your advice on who should take the lead in this matter. And in that connection, you briefly touched on it. Also, do you feel that the which pockets of India do you think the growth is going to come from?
Okay, Vikram, my clear thinking on this area is that, you know, if you're always, you know, waiting and watching what the game is and then kind of reacting, I think half of the game is lost. Okay, so I strongly believe that, you know, you need to be on a front foot in terms of looking at really adapting yourself to the situation rather than saying that, for the time being, let me kind of watch my bottom line and see in terms of what really happens and then play my cards, you know, as I kind of go ahead. So I would say that, you know, say for, you know, like us, we felt very clearly that, you know, advertising is not like an on and off switch that you can switch it off as you want. And it kind of really, as Sam also said, it takes a lot of time to really get back to from where you were in terms of brand saliency, in terms of possibly a certain messaging which you want to give to your consumers. Because I think these are the times when consumers also kind of test you, okay? Today, if you can't take that loyalty for granted in terms of saying that the customers who have been with you for some time will always be with you, okay? And today's consumer is changing very, very dynamically from that point of view. So I would always kind of pitch in the favor of saying that brands which look at simulating demand and look at in terms of preempting the change which is happening and therefore kind of navigating in that area in that way would be something would always kind of gain. And that is something which possibly is something which, you know, a brand like ours also would kind of focus. So for instance, I wanted to give two examples. What we did very clearly at this point of time when we saw that this whole paranoia of people not painting and not getting into, you know, their, you know, not allowing anyone to get into their homes, we started a very strong campaign, and it was a full-fledged campaign on TV, which we did with respect to safe painting. And the fact that today, you know, while those safe painting people look like astronauts who are coming into your house, it was something which kind of gave customers a very, very strong kind of a reassurance and got that paranoia of their mind that today in this environment, if there is a maintenance-led activity, there is something they need to kind of do about their homes, that cannot wait forever. And that is something which kind of really stimulated a lot of business in terms of what really happened. And today, you know, what we are really realizing is that we need to kind of understand the pitch. You know, today, look at consumers. Today, home has become a very strong place. And today, people would do anything because you are spending almost 24 hours in that home. And we kind of approach that very strongly from the point of view of saying that, you know, the whole kind of area of Har Ghar can be a very, very strong point at this point of time, even if people were not kind of really thinking of painting. And you could do small little things in terms of really kind of looking at doing stuff within your home. So you simulated that demand and we launched something which is like a small DIY repair range for the customers to kind of take. So I would say that I would very, very strongly bat for people who would kind of really preempt and really look at adapting them to the environment and look at simulating rather than, you know, waiting and seeing in terms of how they want to react when good times come. Okay. In the marketing world, sometimes I feel that good and bad times is what you make out of it, okay? And it is up to a brand in terms of how you want to kind of really take the trajectory which you want to kind of take. And I think that's something which possibly is the game which, you know, possibly some good brands would always play as you kind of look at the longer terms of how you want to be in the game. So I think that's first part in terms of what you asked. Second, you spoke of, you know, some which pockets which you think in terms of which are going to be important and looking at, you know, how it kind of goes. I would still kind of give a lot of pitch for, you know, tier three, tier four cities, you know, because I think geographically, when you look at some of those geographies, they are still relatively doing much better. Okay. The disposition against, you know, carrying on life as usual is much, much more. And the whole area in terms of the paranoia, you know, around the COVID is much lesser. But and I would say that, you know, today what we have seen is that when we look at the pan India kind of a thing, you know, almost across geographies, okay, you find that there are pockets which are coming up, which are really kind of growing. And that is something which seems to be a story. And it is only the metros and T1, which is basically a little bit pulling the whole thing back to that extent, because the paranoia there seems to be still very, very high in terms of how is it going. So I would say that today in whole, as I see it, is I think there are these pockets of people adapting to the new norm across the country, especially when you start going into the hinterland, look at T3, T4 cities across geographies. I think they seem to be doing well overall.
Great. No, that's a very clear direction. Now, Kunal, from your standpoint, do you think that, very simply put, advertising will stimulate demand? And specifically, if you look at, you know, some of the categories which have been very challenged, so hospitality and travel, I don't know what's going to get them out of this at this point in time, but retail, durables, the entire real estate piece, actually the home improvement one, it's very nice because that obviously painters and all is something that Amit just talked, he's actually used innovation and some great examples to see even now in those categories you can stimulate demand. But a lot of our clients in retail, durables, and some of the real estate people are feeling a little challenged right now. Do you think advertising will stimulate demand even for them?
I can more intelligently speak to retail. I don't want to suddenly claim to be an expert in five other industries on this panel. But specifically on retail / e-com, I think retail, it's not about advertising as much as it is the consumer behavior of wanting to stay inside, right? So I think some amount can be stimulated for sure. In e-commerce specifically, we are seeing a significant impact of advertising to stimulate demand. I think one thing we have to realize is that because of this pandemic, there has been a tectonic plate shift in the amount of time spent online. And I don't think that's going to, after everything, the 7 billion people are vaccinated and whatnot, I don't think that's going to go down materially from here on. It may actually grow from here. I don't think it's going to come down. And what that has various implications for how advertisers think about where they want to advertise and how they want to advertise. So what this has done in the near term is, because the amount of time spent has increased so considerably, it has driven down digital CPMs quite significantly. And what that means is advertisers like us and others are really pressing the pedal on digital advertising as we speak. And we are seeing, at least in our experience, and I'm sure experience of other companies in our space, where they are, because of the increased advertising that they're doing, more and more consumers are coming and buying. It does help from a behavior standpoint that we're able to save consumers the visit to the stores and the visit to and the potential risk that comes with it. But notwithstanding that, I think there is this general trend we are seeing, which is about, you know, taking the goods to the buyers rather than taking the buyers to the goods. And so through advertising, what we are seeing is we are now able to take essentially our goods to the buyers because they're just spending so much time online. I think I just want to reference the part about that Amit nicely mentioned about the small towns and the hinterlands. We are seeing tremendous growth in both time spent as well as ad engagement or engagement with advertising online from consumers in small towns. And that is driving a significant push of or significant pull, I should say, of sales from those parts of the country. And we've added in the last 3 months, maybe over 5 million new buyers. And we've not spent anything on above the line advertising, etc. We've been very focused on digital. So digital has that type of throughput today to drive such a large number of consumers in the midst of a pandemic to a commerce platform online. I do want to make a point about festive, because I don't know if I'll get the chance on the next round, but I do sense that we will see companies spend money in our space, in digital space, spend money on media during the festive season. I'm sure everyone saw about Dream Eleven IPL bid, successful bid today. However, I feel that at the same time, there is a strong shift that I'm observing a few quarters leading into the pandemic and accelerating now, which is where advertisers who have highly trackable spends on their most of their advertising, which would be most of the digital companies, are now demanding and expecting a similar ROI out of their mass media spends as well. So people are testing all kinds of formats in mass media that they're running ads, like brand ads, but the brand ads need to deliver ROI. So they'll put a phone number in there. They'll have various kinds of call to action. Even in print ads, we are seeing that. So I think there is a clear shift happening as how the very ROI obsessed advertisers are spending even on mass media channels. So I'll stop there, but I think
you've done a resounding thumbs up for digital to stimulate demand, but we've got TV and print friends on this panel. So what is the
digital asset?
Yeah, I know digital, you've got your thumbs up, but I'm just saying that what is your apprehension about the ROI not coming in from TV and print based on? So if there was a big sale, would you not use them?
I think we would be, but we would do it, but then we would also benchmark the ROI across the various channels. And then future spends or increase or decrease of future spends would be subject to that. But bear in mind, Vikram, I think we are in an extraordinary environment where the cost of digital advertising has gone down very, very materially. And hence the ROI of digital advertising has gone up very materially. And hence now advertisers are having to think even harder about where should they allocate their money.
Yeah, I'm just underscoring the point that Kunal made, that with this heavy demand on with consumers spending more and more time online, the cost per thousands have actually come down because you're able to buy inventory much cheaper because there's so many more people out there. So I'm just underscoring that point, which makes the efficiency story, apart from the effectiveness story for digital, that much stronger. But Shailesh, I remember you told me, this was I think in June, when just about after a very disastrous April, May, in June, you said the first guys to see the opportunity in print were, as Amit also said earlier and all, were really the people in the small towns and the entrepreneurs in the small and medium enterprises, local marketers. Now, what is it that those entrepreneurs are getting which cover your ass, brand managers or not? What is it that you'd like to learn from the local advertisers speak to and tell the global advertisers, what's the trick they're missing? Sorry, I can't hear you.
Mute. Sorry, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to say is that local advertiser really does not, they advertise to earn, they advertise for action. They don't care about the brand building. If we talk about UP, Bihar, Jharkhand, which in itself are as big as any small European country would be, so they are country in themselves, right? And in June, July, August has been a classic case that June, July has been a classic case where these local advertisers have come in abundance, and they have only asked or repeated their advertising because they were getting the return either through home deliveries, which they were doing, or calling people to the shops, because as Avinash was also saying, the effect of this pandemic in our towns, which Mr. Amit was also saying, tier 3 and tier 4, but even if you see tier 2, like a Kanpur or Lucknow, believe you and me, there is no effect when you go to the market or when you go onto the road. The life is as normal as it can be. People sitting in Mumbai, Delhi, Bangalore, I do not know what they are thinking, but here the retailers, they mean business. They are only advertising, be it a wholesale dealer or a retailer of a sari or of a cloth, or be it a kirana shop. They are all advertising, and they're only advertising when they are getting. Only good thing which has happened is now the home delivery. They have started doing deliveries or other mode of other mode of selling their goods. So that has so been.
You'll be willing to tango with Kunal on a ROI story on print advertising. He'll advertise with you, and then you'll give him the returns, and he'll come and advertise more.
Well, we can always talk about it. As I said, we need to go back to the basics, and it is an extra, you know, these are not normal times. So you need to think innovatively, you think differently. Agar hum purane tarike se bechte rahe, that won't really work. You have to rediscover things in a newer way. Keep it simple.
Okay. Keep it simple. Okay, Rohit, you've probably been the master of selling impact. Now, impact is also just about every format, whether it's cricket, reality shows, or whatever you have it. You've really maxed it out. We also believe that impact is the one which actually does a good job of stimulating fresh money from the market. And like you were saying yourself, we've got a plethora of big ticket impacts coming in September, October, November. What do you think is the opportunity that we should tell advertisers here that this is why you should spend these kind of fees or elsewhere, but especially in these properties to actually grow business? What's your elevator pitch to these guys, because you've done it so well?
So Vikram, obviously even for companies which are very ROI driven and CPM, CPC conscious, whatever you might call it, when it comes to impact, one thing is very clear that in India, impact delivers. And, that's why, advertisers do come back with association on a certain property. So especially during the festive period, there is so much of clutter, you need to get out of it. And impact is the only way where you get out of the clutter and your brand can stand out, because it's just not the value you pay on the impact, because even from a broadcaster perspective, there's a brand solution, there are a lot of other ideas which go beyond the 30-second spot you get in terms of brand association with the property. So I think it's critical, especially in this period of time, in the festive period. And I think that's what stands out, and that's why brands do come again and again buying impact properties. You can do a lot of advertising, but if it doesn't stand out during this period, you can get lost, because there's so much of advertising happening. Virtually every brand in India, smallest to the biggest, is active. How do you stand out? So I think that while you will buy your regular spots across, would need one or two properties to really get your message across. And I think that's really tested. It's been tested over a period of time. It's nothing new which is happening. Formats are getting more better. We understand customers' requirement far more than which was there earlier. And I think what this has taught us, this COVID period has taught us, and our discussions with a lot of brands in the last couple of months on impact has been that, obviously, we need to give far better solutions than we've given before for us to be able to get that money. So you've got to think outside the box, think outside the format, and see how do you create that association. If you're not able to create that association, I don't think the brand is also going to put in that with you, because obviously that comes at a premium. Brand is going to pay a premium, and he doesn't get that association, there's no need for him to pay that. Because you can get enough of 30-second spots across any channels. There are 800 channels in India. So they sell from $200 to. So I think the issues, it's not about the adex. I think it's about the association which you're able to create. And that is where the differentiator lies.
Great. And Avinash, look, what we hear about this entire demand versus house, whether it's going to be subdued or it's going to be really rocking, it's a lot of people say that sentiment has got a lot to do with it. Now, it's the kind of talks that you're having. If you're having a good bullish, like the Amit has Amit is the big bull because he's always got ideas and he's always saying that we can get ourselves out of it. But if you go to several organizations, you have a fair amount of pessimism there, and the entire sentiment is not probably the most bullish. Now, I think the stock market, for some strange reasons, I don't know who was at stake, but you've all seen the memes where the bull is on top of a building and saying now he doesn't know how to get down. If it can happen in a stock market in a pretty bleak thing, what do we have to do it in the, if Sensex can do it, what can the ADEX do? What is the sentiment that we have to dial up? So what is that narrative?
I can tell you, and I'm not saying this for the first time, that Indians are very, very positive looking people. We are not as gloomy as the Western country. If you look at the basic data of death, okay, by suicide, it's a very, very in India. एक कोई वर्ड नहीं है इसके लिए हिंदुस्तानी में आत्महत्या इज अ टू वर्ड वाइल सुसाइड इज अ सिंगल वर्ड इन आवर कंट्री द ग्लूम द डिप्रेशन दीज वर्ड्स डिड नॉट एग्जिस्ट अबाउट 10 इयर्स अगो वी आर पॉजिटिव फॉरवर्ड लुकिंग पीपल एंड दैट्स द रीजन दैट यू सॉ व्हाइल इन द जून इट वाज पीक इन दिल्ली एंड बॉम्बे इन कोविड बैंगलोर एंड चेन्नई स्टिल इज एंड दे वर गेटिंग इन टू दिस The advertising industry was booming. We have all our channels inventory full. Clients were advertising, and as Amit rightly said, the sales were picking. As Kunal mentioned today, the people are advertising and pushing up their sales. Somebody is buying it, right? And buying happens for consumption. So for television industry, for the broadcast business that I am in, it is very important to tell the both sides of the narrative that Corona is curable. There is an end to it. We don't know when it is ending, but there is an end to it, like an end to everything else. The second thing is this, that lot is happening in this country. You have new reformed education system, which is going to take shape, which is going to change the way our new youth would be 10 years later, 15 years later. There is a positivity. We are doing IPL after all this. And so many shows, including Rohit channel, is launching new shows. So we have come back from where we are, and television as an industry and news channel as an industry, as you can see, we have so much to cover today that even despite the massive flood that Amit mentioned in Bihar and part of Uttar Pradesh, Gujarat, Rajasthan, in fact, Rajasthan is having massive flood. The normal activity is booming. Retail advertisers are advertising for sale. I will tell you, we have a client, I will not disclose where, retail advertiser, single store owner has signed $1.5 million deal in the month of June. That's the positivity that an Indian entrepreneur has got. And that's what, as a boss, it is our fundamental duty to encourage that and to make the country happen. You know, and that's what as a news doing it right now.
No, just
whether we get the rate or not, Vikram.
I'll get towards the closing thing now, because there's one part which I just wanted to touch on, the very sensitive issue of pricing. Now, yeah, of course, media owners will always say that everybody's bringing down the price and unviable. And marketers, of course, right now, things have gone pretty bad for us overall, and we have to try to conserve cost. And end of the day, we have to strive to get efficiencies. That's how we can advertise. Now, how can there be a sensible conversation about pricing? Now, of course, the reality is it's a demand-supply situation. If the demand is going to be more, prices go up. If supply is going to be more, prices come down. So, but if how can there be a simple conversation? Because there's a lot of hot air and venting that happens, both from an advertiser standpoint and from a media owner standpoint. From the other ends, and of course, the agency is the one screwed in the middle. So, on this particular one, Amit, just if you can weigh in on this, that what is a sensible way of our price at this point in time when it comes to media? Because, and you're one of the most, you've paid premiums, but at the same time, you're as tough to negotiating when you have to. So what's our way of having this conversation? Because the people on my right now will feel that advertisers are really, in fact, April, May, June, there's been a huge amount of discounting happening. And and so on and so forth. So now, what is do you have a sensible sort of rule of engagement on this one?
So obviously, I think one rule is that put pressure on Vikram and Sam, and you'll get what you want. Okay, so that is a good rule in terms of really looking at it. I honestly feel that, you know, sometimes in this entire area, the important thing for everyone to realize is that is there a win-win situation are we creating? I think it makes a lot of sense in terms of saying that if you are all working towards a direction which is mutually great, okay, it will always kind of go in the right direction. And see, I always also keep on saying that for some of the some of the channels, it's great to kind of really invest in brands from a point of view of saying that you're not looking at a short term in terms of just a season or 6 months or a year. You know, you are investing in a brand from a long term point of view as well. And sometimes, you know, I would kind of try to look at saying that even if I have to pay a little premium at this point of time, but I have a sense in terms of from where the channel is coming in terms of supporting you. Okay, it would kind of good win-win situation in terms of being with the brand in terms of that property in, which is kind of bringing out to you. At the same, you know, the media partner has to be also very careful that are you in the zone of only extracting and not really giving. And therefore, I think the name of the game is that if you are able to show, obviously, the client that I give you 4x ROI at 2x spend, you know, it's something which is really great in terms of what possibly a brand will buy into. So I would kind of really channelize it from the point of view of saying, one, you know, create win-win situations. Look at basically not only short-term orientations, but look at orientations in terms of being for a longer time with each other. And look at in terms of what impacts which you can create for a brand, which the brand would really remember you in terms of being partnering them in times when their times are not really great.
Great. I'm going to now move to the media side and come back to you, Kunal, after this question. Now, Rohit, typically, we've always found TV during festival, this is the time when TV takes up pricing. It also is a time when there's a huge amount of inventory and spots are dropped and all those kind of things. So if you have to talk exact thing that Amit is saying right now, how do you think this festive season, media owners or and talk from a TV standpoint, how should they behave in order to give confidence to people who are already a bit on the fence on whether to spend or not?
See, I'd only like to say that, Vikram, I mean, at least I can say for our network is that we, whether it's this festival, the last festival, the next festival, whatever it be, we've never looked at any festival as an opportunist time to, hey, this is the time I must get a little extra from let's say, Amit. You know, we've never looked at it like that. For us, it's a relationship which is built, and whatever price we agree to is an agreed price, and whatever the deliveries we've agreed to, we will deliver or more. And I think that's the relationship. So if you've seen us, we've never made price announcement, hey, we're going for a 20% price increase or a 15% price increase or whatever. That's not the way we operate. For us, we operate, as you know it very well, we operate with very few clients. We don't operate with every client in the industry. We operate with very few clients, but the clients which we operated, we've got a relationship going over years, many years. So one COVID is not going to make that difference because the client, like Amit said, understands that issue. And I think that's the way forward. So again, it's very difficult to answer, to say whether prices will up, go down, whatever. But if, like I said in my earlier point, is that if I'm able to create value, which, the advertisers, whether Kunal or Amit can see that value, and he will pay the price for it. If he doesn't see the value, he's not going to pay the price for any broadcaster. Forget anything. For any buy. So I think that's where the difference is. And I don't think you can be opportunist at this point, especially now. I think you will never succeed if you're opportunist, especially in this time.
So Kunal, on that one, he's thrown it to you. So would you go for lower CPM or would you go for value? And if so, is it a direct ROI that you're looking at, or is there an intangible to it?
So I think there is always, during these points of market dislocations, there is this temptation of trying to spend a lot of time deal hunting. I at least don't do a lot of that as a company. We tend to figure out what are something enduring advantages or capabilities we can build that are highly replicable over quarters and years, rather than, oh, we got this really great deal of this particular property. We don't spend too much time on that, because for businesses that operate at scale, it's highly unlikely you will replicate that over and over again. So they take a lot of time. They don't yield lasting advantages for a business. So what we spend, we are actually almost ambivalent to the price of media. The price could be as high or as low in absolute. What we care about is, did we make more than we spent media back in terms of our margin, not our top line, right? So the unit economics of that spend is far more important. How much we spend is just a number. And it usually varies very widely depending on, like, whether it's a print or TV or digital video or digital performance or affiliate networks or, you know, TikTok ads or formerly TikTok ads. I think we are almost ambivalent to what the absolute number we're spending. We are very sensitive to how much do we make in terms of our margin on every, let's say, on an index basis, 100 units of marketing spend. So that just keeps organizations intellectually very honest on building capabilities that can replicate high ROI spending than trying to deal hunt in a bespoke manner.
Great. Okay, Shailesh, right on print, you typically sell during season by, typically you come with these great schemes and mop up money, you're willing to give discounts if there's outlay coming in. And of course, there is a lot of impact inventory like jackets and all. And of course, the positioning that the wars are fought between top jacket and second jacket and all that. But now, would you like to use this forum today to sort of say how you're going to treat this festive any different? Because the green shoots of print are just about emerging, reach the level that print and TV have, sorry, TV and digital in terms of resurgence. So is there, on this forum, would you like to talk about how you intend to approach festive?
Sure, Vikram. This festive also, as I said earlier, we'll keep it simple. It will be more dynamic than last year. It'll be much more interesting than last year, because we understand that from which market or from what, at what timing we are coming. And Jagran as a company always believes that the partners, the festive time in North is very, very special, you know, and the relationship that Jagran has with the advertisers. We believe that festive time is important for every advertiser. Hence, you'll only see in Jagran during festive time, we actually, as Rohit said, that they decide a price for a year. But even when we decide a price for a year, festive time, we actually reduce that price because we want to give more to the partners who are, you know, who are getting associated with us. And this year, again, as I said, it is a pandemic time. Everybody is coming out of a tough time. It will be very, very interesting when you see what we do. And normally what we do during festive time, we call it a casino grande. And it'll be very, very different this year. Very simple and a lot of value for an advertiser. Because we really want these others. We strongly feel that tier two and tier three towns will decide the economy of the country in months and coming years.
Excellent.
So activating those markets is very important.
Okay, I'm just a little mindful of the time. So I will now just come to your closing comments. I think all of you have said that it requires a fair degree of fresh, proactive, innovative thinking to actually work our way through this entire year. Now, would love it if we, in closing, you can all go one by one and say, what is the one advice you'd like to give marketers or media that they need differently in 2020 from anything they've done in the past? Avinash, can we start with you? What should people do differently this year?
I think you have to be spending a lot of money on TV news channels, first of all. It has proven that people watch news channels more and more. So that's the because I did not get the chance in the last round. So I'll say that it is likely to increase the price, because thanks to TO2, you will have less and less channels. Remember that in the second phase of the year. And please be innovative, buy impact, because that will reduce the inventory. It will gather attention on the brand, and it will also help sell you more. From the advertising perspective, this is the advice that I'll give to all my.
Kunal, what is the one advice or two things that you'd like to do differently, or you'd like to tell people to do differently?
I think consistency is underrated. I feel that at the end of the day, as an advertiser, you should just keep doing in a lasting, enduring manner what is scalable in terms of the economics of doing it again and again. So if there is a particular method of advertising, whether it could be mass media, it could be digital, it could be a combination, if it's working for you and has been working for you, just keep doing it as long as the ROI is positive. Right. Sometimes one has to be innovative. Sometimes one has to stick to the knitting. I feel that during this period, for us to crack the code of how to be unit economics positive on their spends, they should just stick to the knitting and work with a lot of consistency during this volatile period.
Okay. So, vote for consistency, stick to the knitting. Rohit, what would you say?
So I think keep it simple. I think brands it takes a long time to build a brand. So I think brand association is key. You've got to see what other associations will work best for you. And I think that's the way forward. And I think in an environment where there's going to be this year, like any other festival, there's going to be a lot of clutter. How does your brand shout out louder? That's important to see. So it's just the association. With the right channels, associated with the right brand, kind of thing. That's good. So I think simplicity is the best.
Rather than simplicity, so you're not doing different things. You're getting more of the same. Simple and impact also seems to be there. Shailesh, what about you? What any advice on what we should do different?
Well, you
use the word simple twice already.
Yeah. So I will add just one more thing. Go back to basics. Don't try too hard. Keep it simple. Keep it sales oriented. That's it. Right now, the time is to get the sales. That's it.
Okay. Amit, you get the last word. So your advice to all the marketers and media people listening to you.
So I would say that, in this whole maddening environment and the uncertainty, don't forget your consumer. Don't forget the customer, okay? Try to reach out to customer in as many ways you can, okay? This is not a time when you can really stay away from the consumer. So you need to reach out to your consumer, whether it is through digital, whether it is through TV, whatever works for you in terms of reaching the TG which you are kind of thinking of, you would kind of really look at doing that very, very well. And I would say that, one of the big opportunities in coming times is I think regional media would, I think, become big definitely this year as well. Because I think as we start looking at tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 cities, I think regional media would be very, very important in terms of looking whether it is TV, whether it is print or whether it is digital. I think all forms would be very, very important.
Wonderful.
On a lighter note, Amit bhai, we have a coffee?
Yeah. Okay, but I'd like to thank our esteemed panel. They were wonderful, and I think they've given us a lot of insight and a lot of learnings as to how to sort of navigate this season. I see a lot of measured optimism out here. We can't just go wild on this one, but I think we've got to go back to principles. Keep it simple. Keep your customer in mind. Keep your consumer in mind. And don't be scared of leading the demand. You should lead the demand. So basically do all it takes to stimulate it. Thank you all, and I'll now hand it back to
you. Thank you so much, Vikram. And thank you also to all our esteemed panels for that highly insightful discussion. We've had so many comments and questions coming our way. But now I would once again like to invite Vikram to share with us few concluding remarks for this evening's proceedings and also from today's panel discussion. So the virtual stage is all yours, Vikram.
Okay. I think it's clear to all of us that this has been a very unprecedented year. What Sam actually pointed out was that we actually can get a pretty reasonably high range of growth. He's talking 6 to 13% versus 19 and a pretty large 70% kind of growth versus H1. A lot of it is going to be dependent on actually what happens now in the months to come. So I think that is the, and he of course gave us five reasons, and I think a lot, some of them were very sensible in terms of we all stand for marketing, we believe in marketing. And once again, I think this is not the time to think of marketing as a cost, but marketing as an investment. I think our panel has also sort of stressed this. And I think it's important right now for all marketers to remember that demand creation is their job. And this is the opportunity. We have a very optimistic and a very buoyant kind of a Indian population. And there are pockets of pain, but there are large tracts of land or of the country which are doing absolutely fine. So I think choose your battlefields, go regional, go smart, and actually spend well, and you're going to get a great return. And I hope we all have a very good festival, the entire Diwali, and it's all of us are really coming out smiling at the end of it. Thank you.
Thank you once again. Thank you so much, Vikram. I think for everybody out here, I would remember this very line that marketing, don't think of it as a cost, but as an investment. And ladies and gentlemen, with that, I think I speak for most of the audience that this has been the most enlightening evening, putting the impact of COVID-19 into perspective and also providing a clearer picture of what our H2 2020 is going to shape up like. So ladies and gentlemen, now I would like to invite on the screen to just conclude this evening's proceedings and also to deliver a vote of thanks. May I please call upon Ms. Lara Balsara Wajiftar, Executive Director, Madison World, to join me on the screen. Very warm welcome.
So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and all 513 of you to be precise, for being with us virtually as we launch this very special report. Thank you also to Avinash and the ABP team for always supporting this event right since inception and even now in these unusual circumstances. A special thank you to our tech partner, Madison Turnt, for jazzing up this platform to make it a visual treat as we all sit in the comforts of our home and watch this. So 2020 has turned out to be a year that all of us want to forget. So when we met in February to launch the report, the economy had already slowed down, but we were hoping for a 10% growth in 2020 with a subdued H1, but a buoyant H2. Who knew then that within 45 days, the whole world would come to a standstill? But I think with a 60 to 70% growth in H2 over H1 that the report forecasts, we can still expect a buoyant H2. I am reminded of Sanjay Bell's passionate presentation when we launched the Pitch Madison report in February. He said, self-destruct or perish. I guess we've all done this in the last 5 months and we'll have to do more of it in the next five. And as they say, when the going gets tough, the tough get going, and haven't we got going. So on this positive note, thank you once again, ladies and gentlemen, and have a very good evening.
Thank you so much to our panelists and of course to our partners, and a special thank you to Madison World team. This is me, Khyati Kawa, signing off. Thank you very much, and we will see you again very soon.